Welcome to the Dr. J Show, a production of the Ruth Institute. The Ruth Institute is building an interfaith coalition to defend the family. Marriage and family are universal. Everyone comes into the world as a helpless baby. Everyone has a mom and a dad, and every society has a responsibility to its children. We believe the best for children is mothers and fathers who cooperate in a lifelong union of love, surrounded by a culture that supports these aspirations. The evidence is on our side. You can count on the Ruth Institute to know what they're talking about, and you can count on Dr. J to help you put your faith into action and make a difference.
I'm Father Mark Hodges, and here are the headlines. The National Center for Health Statistics put out a report last year on unmarried couples living together. Cohabitation is commonplace. Since 1995, the percentage of women 19 to 44 who have cohabited has increased by 82%. The report confirmed that serial cohabitation is strongly associated with poverty, lower odds of marriage, and increased odds of divorce. Cohabitating men and women tend to be poorer. They tend to have lower levels of education. They're also more likely to report having an unintended birth, and cohabiting parents are much more likely than married parents to break up, resulting in increased odds of family instability for children. Even cohabiting couples that eventually marry report lower average marital quality and greater likelihood of divorce. Dr. Scott Stanley wrote in Psychology Today that, quote, "The increase in cohabitation, serial cohabitation, and premarital cohabitation has led to consistent downward trends in the belief that marriage is special." A coalition of pro-life medical organizations lambasted recent statements in favor of forcing medical professionals to participate in abortion. Six major medical guilds have taken a public stand against conscience protections, including the American Psychiatric Association. The pro-life coalition letter calls on a group of six left-leaning medical guilds to acknowledge the scientific fact that every human person's life begins at conception and to recommit to the ancient medical ethics principle of first, do no harm. The coalition of pro-life healthcare organizations includes the American College of Pediatricians, whose president, Dr. Michelle Cortella, said, "Death is not a state of health. Killing is not caring. Abortion, assisted suicide, and euthanasia are not health care." The Pro-Life Coalition encourages doctors to recognize the right to life of all human beings, regardless of age, stage of development, physical ability, mental ability, state of dependency, or the subjective designation of, quote, "being wanted," unquote. If you have ever had any concerns about birth control side effects, you now have a chance to make your voice heard. A citizen's petition has been filed asking the Food and Drug Administration to improve patient information and transparency regarding the risks of birth control, such as the pill, the IUD, the shot, the patch, and the vaginal ring. If this petition is heeded by the FDA, it would result in new label warnings and greater physician awareness. Birth control risks include cervical cancer, breast cancer, inflammatory bowel disease, device migration, multiple sclerosis, urogenital problems, life-threatening blood clots, and lupus. The more doctors and birth control users speak up, the greater the chance the FDA will respond in government action. To comment, pause this broadcast right now and write down the web address shown below. Paste that web address into your browser and click on the Comment Now button on the right. Dr. Henry Benson of Britain's Marriage Foundation and Dr. Steve McKay of the University of Lincoln looked into what makes a happy marriage. Using a British survey conducted in 2014 and 2015, they compared the daily activities with the reported marital happiness of over 7,600 people in 4,000 households. They found that married couples who eat together are more likely to report maximum happiness with each other. They also found that couples who eat together are significantly more likely to enjoy their meal. But those who use the phone during meals are less likely to enjoy their meal. Dr. Benson concluded, "So, if you want a happy relationship and want to enjoy your meals more, then eat together as a couple and put that phone down." And finally, Ruth Institute founder and president, Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, is defending children against the nation's most famous association of therapists. A division of the American Psychological Association announced a task force to promote, quote, awareness and inclusivity, unquote, about what it calls consensual non-monogamy. Non-monogamy means multiple concurrent sexual partners. In plain English, adultery. Quote, the APA is completely ignoring the impact of adult sexual behavior on children, Dr. Moore said. She pointed out, the APA's position is that as long as sex is consensual, no judgment should be attached. But in the Me Too era, haven't we learned just how thin a reed consent can be? The idea that everyone is entitled to all the sex they want, whenever they want, regardless of the consequences, is a basic belief of the sexual revolution. It's proven a disastrous recipe for illegitimate children, fatherless families, and divorce. The Ruth Institute believes every child has the right to a relationship with their natural mother and father, except in cases of an unavoidable tragedy. Dr. Morse's latest book is The Sexual State, How Elite Ideologies Are Destroying Lives and How the Church Was Right All Along.
This week, we bring in an expert who will help you defend the truth about marriage and family and human sexuality. And now for Dr. J's featured interview with our special guest, Brandon Showalter.
So let's begin with a prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Lord God, we ask your protection on this interview. You know everything, and we don't. If we be mistaken in anything we say, let no one be misled by anything we say, and let everything be for your greater glory, amen. In your perfect way and your perfect will. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Welcome to the Dr. J Show, everybody. Today, my guest is Brandon Showalter. Since June of 2016, Brandon Showalter has been a journalist with the Christian Post. He enjoys exploring the intersection of faith and politics and has reported on a wide range of subjects. Earlier this year, he became the host of the Christian Post podcast. He was first inspired to break into a career in writing and journalism while mopping floors and scrubbing toilets as a church custodian in April 2015, and we are not going to hear that story today. I'm sure there'll be another time we can hear that story. In 2007, Brandon earned a BA from Bridgewater College of Virginia. He's a fellow of the John Jay Institute for Faith, Society, and Law, and he's a graduate of a three-year program at Bethel School of Ministry in Redding, California. He serves on the board of the Brushfires Foundation, which is a ministry that equips Christian leaders to foster sexual integrity, healing, and wholeness in their churches and communities. And it says here that his most favorite thing to do in life is to sing, and that in 2014 he released an EP called Song of Psalms, which sounds really great. So, Brandon, welcome to the Dr. J Show.
Thank you, Dr. J. So good to be with you.
All right, so I have three litmus test questions before we can go any further.
If you can't, fire away.
If you can't answer these, man, we're done, okay?
Okay.
Number one, do you believe marriage is between a man and a woman?
Absolutely.
Thank you. Number two, do you love the Lord your God with all your mind, heart, soul, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself?
Absolutely.
All right, very good. Number three, are you willing to be seen in public with me, Dr. J?
Absolutely.
All right, then we can get this done. If you're not embarrassed, that's all good. Okay, so, Brandon, the reason I wanted to have you come on the show is that you have done some of the most interesting and important reporting on transgenderism and the problems associated with transgenderism. How did you get interested in such a topic?
Well, as you mentioned there in the intro, it was actually soon after I started at CP. Summer of 2016 is when the Pulse nightclub shooting happened, and it was actually my first day was the day after that.
Is that right? And,
yes. Wow. And so I was soon asked to write stories about that and the Christian response to it particularly. And it was right about that time when, you know, one of my editors, here I am just newbie reporter, said, "Oh, you know, you're writing these articles and we don't have to edit your stuff for tone because you're very truthful but gracious in your writing. So here I am just thinking, well, if I'm excelling here, I'll pitch more stories along these same lines." But same-sex marriage had been legalized for about a year at that point, and so there really wasn't a whole lot in terms of what the big LGBT organizations were pushing on that front, so much as it was transgender rights. That was ascendant. And to be honest, I'd read a little bit about it, but I think like most people, I sort of thought that transgender persons were like the oddballs down in Mardi Gras, transvestites or something, and I just didn't really realize where this was all going. But as I started to dig deeper, I realized that, oh my, this was so far beyond anything that the, you know, LGBT organizations had pushed before. And I've since come to learn that there's a lot of LGs and Bs that are not too happy about this. But what was a key moment for me where I was never the same person again was when I realized that chemical puberty blocking drugs were actually a thing, and that they were being given to minor children. And once I learned about the medicalization of this, I just knew that I was going to have to continue to report on this because I saw the extent of the mainstream media's deception about this issue and how they were framing it. Whereas the only people who dared to tell the truth about it, who were daring to tell the truth about it, were conservative-leaning Catholics, Christians, and radical feminists, and some dissident gays and lesbians. They were the only people who, through various alternative, less read media outlets, were actually writing about it. And so, as someone who works for the Christian Post, incidentally, this issue became one of my beats, as we have in the news biz, but I just have not been able to look away because the horrors are unending.
Well, you know, Brandon, I have to tell you, as you know, I'm not squeamish, and I get involved in some very controversial things, and
right.
I'm not a shrinking violet or anything, but sometimes I can't finish reading your articles. I'll get part of the way into it, and I just go, I have to avert my eyes. It's really bad. So let's back up and maybe define things a little bit for people.
Sure.
The concept that people have that's been kind of sold to the public is that a transgender person is a person who has been born in the wrong body. There's no medical issue. They're not intersex. That's a completely different type of issue. This is a person who is who's genetically and physically completely all male, but somehow they think that they are really female and there's been some kind of mistake or, you know, switched at birth or something, or vice versa for a girl. There's nothing wrong with her female body. It's all functioning fine. There's no ambiguity about the body. But somehow in her mind, she thinks she's really a boy. What are some of the psychological issues that you've seen that might lead a person to come to the conclusion they've been born in the wrong body?
Well, far be it from me to universalize this, and because every person has their own specific situation, and it's a very complex issue, and there's many factors that I think would contribute, but there are patterns, and
yes.
I think for many people who identify themselves as trans or non-binary or any of these, you know, multiple new gender identities, I think for some it's a fetish. For it's autogynephilia. It's males who get some kind of a thrill off of wearing women's clothing or appearing as a woman. For children, I think it
so
there
hold
are
on,
there are
hold
some
on, hold on
okay.
right there, because that's a $10 word that a lot of people have never heard before.
Right.
I know what you're talking about. Autogynephilia is a fetish, a sexual fetish, which means
right.
the man becomes sexually aroused by viewing himself as a woman. And that is
correct.
That's a thing, okay? And that's been defined and discovered by certain psychologists and psychiatrists.
Correct.
But the trans activists deny that such a thing exists, right? Am I right? They think that is demeaning somehow.
That's basically right. It's that their fetish isn't really a fetish. It's integral to who they are because they really were born in the wrong body. And they're an oppressed minority. You're not allowed to look at them as weird because they're oppressed. But the autogynephilia factors in. They don't want to deny that it's a perverse fetish or anything.
Right. Okay. So that's one category.
Right.
And that's a little bit different from some of the
right.
other categories. So go ahead.
With children, there are those who I think have been. It makes perfect sense to me that, and we know this to be true, that there are a lot of victims of family or sexual trauma that then become very confused about who they are, the most basic facts of their being, and so that's a contributing factor. There's another thing, this transgender craze is very prevalent online on sites like Tumblr and YouTube, where these YouTuber stars talk about how glamorous it is to be transgender. And so it's a social contagion. There's been documented research about how these outbreaks among youth who suddenly, after not showing any signs of gender confusion whatsoever, all of a sudden, out of nowhere, seemingly come to this understanding of themselves. But also, I mean, I can't underscore the role of really twisted educational curricula that are telling young minds, young children in school, that there's more than male and female, and there's such a thing as cisgender and transgender. The confusion that is being sown into impressionable developing minds is just staggering. And so there's not one cause of this.
Right.
And I don't want to diminish the very real psychological suffering of the
right.
people who, for whatever reason,
right.
Psychologists have diagnosed genuine confusion in children about their bodies, and I'm sure it's torturous, and we owe them nothing but compassion. And yet, I think for a lot of people, I'm not going to say it's manufactured. I think there's a degree of it that is manufactured, and this condition has been medicalized, and there's an incentive for, and I know we're probably going to talk about this some later, pharmaceutical companies and drug makers who see gender dysphoric kids as an income stream. And
so,
if they get them hooked on these drugs, they will be patients for life.
So that takes us to the next question. I want you to describe for our listeners and viewers some of the medical interventions or physical interventions that are being performed on young people who express gender dysphoria and so forth. I hesitate to call them medical treatments because these are things being performed on perfectly healthy bodies. These are procedures
right.
and medications. So
right.
describe some of those procedures that you've come across in your research.
Well, like I said, this when I learned what puberty-blocking drugs were, I was a changed man. I could not believe that was even a thing. The idea is that if these kids express gender dysphoria, that they really believe that they are the opposite sex, and I'll note here that I've spoken with people who have bought into this stuff, and one of the biggest deceptions is that they conflate, there's this split psyche thing going on with regard to sex and gender. They might say that they know that they can't chromosomally become the opposite sex. No one has ever switched. I've never seen any scientific literature to say, and we know it's impossible anyway, that you can move from XX chromosomes to XY or vice versa. So even though our sex is stamped on every single cell of our body. It's encoded in our DNA. There are people that still come to believe that, you know, even though if they can't switch sex, they're switching gender, but that really they mean the same thing, and they're treating it as though they're saying I am female when they are male. And so there's it's just fraught with gaslighting with deception. But because of this now, in order to become the opposite gender, the opposite sex, again, though it's physically impossible, they're actually interrupting the normal developmental process of puberty. And so they are you know, these young kids in Tanner stage two, if you use endocrinology language, these hormone blockers that inhibit hormones in boys, for example, around the time where the pubertal signals in the brain begin, they use a drug called Lupron. Lupron is a drug that is used to treat prostate cancer. It's also used to treat sex offenders. And so they're injecting this into these kids, and it blocks the flow of
How old are these kids sometimes?
Well, they're prepubescent ages, you know, 10, 11, around that age. For boys, though I'm seeing signs now of, and that's just the puberty blocker. Once they're on those blockers where they inhibit normal puberty from happening, they go on to opposite sex hormones. So boys are getting, you know, estrogen, girls are getting testosterone, and, you know, progesterone there's a whole cocktail of drugs that are administered at various degrees as they progress. But the problem with that is that puberty is a normal process that everybody needs to go to, and you can't just push pause on this normal developmental process. You don't get those years back. Endocrinologists that I've interviewed have said everyone needs to undergo this process. When it was first, it was a drug. I interviewed an endocrinologist in California who's been one of the best voices speaking out about the dangers and the unethical antics of these people that are administering these drugs. He pointed me to a study that was, I think, the first patient that was given this drug was back, I think, in, I don't know, maybe 16 years ago in the Netherlands, where it was said, you know, in collaboration with a psychiatrist, that if you permit this person to go through puberty, it's going to be so traumatic. That puberty was such a, he was not going to be able to become, or this person was not going to be able to become their true self unless they had, I mean, it's so delusional, but the puberty was this traumatic experience, and thus you need to medicalize it away. No matter, I mean, but you can't do that. The body is not designed for this normal process to be thwarted like it is.
Right.
And it sets people up for a whole host of medical problems.
Tell us a little bit about some of the medical and by the way, so far, audience, he's so far just talking about the chemical side of this. There's also a surgical side of this. So right. Briefly tell people some of the problems associated with the chemical castration or whatever it is that's going on here. And then we'll talk about surgery and how the kids are that are getting surgery.
Well, these puberty-blocking drugs take calcium out of the bones. So these kids are, I mean, you know, your hormones, when your normal hormones, it's part of your, part of the process of puberty is, you know, the hormones flow across your system as they need to, but these blockers take calcium out of the bones that can't be and it can't be reintroduced later. So you're setting these kids up for a risk of osteoporosis later in life. They'll have osteoporosis in their 20s or 30s.
Has this been studied, Brandon?
Are there any
long-term studies of any of this stuff?
These drugs have never been approved by the FDA for this purpose. They are always prescribed off-label, and there have never been any studies done on the long-term side effects. None. There are people that are putting out studies
I know all about studies. I mean, debunked many studies in my day.
Well, there's studies done, but they're by highly politicized organizations. And the one that I'll just mention briefly is the World WPATH, World PATH something for transgender health. I forget the letters of the acronym, but it's a highly politicized group. And what they've done is co-opt a lot of the other more mainstream professional associations like the Endocrine Society and the American Academy for Pediatrics. And so they've got this professional veneer, but there have never been any long-term studies done on these drugs for this purpose. The only time that blockers are approved by the FDA are for when children have what's known as precocious puberty, where they go into, if they're very young children, start their puberty before the normal time. But that, for that condition, even though I think some of these drugs are pretty gnarly anyway, and they have a lot of side effects, that at least they have clinical experiences, there's a broad clinical body of work where they've administered these drugs for a short time to delay it so then their puberty can resume at the proper age. But there is never, but you are actually creating a disease state when you're injecting puberty blockers into a normal healthy body.
Right, right. Okay, so let's go now and talk about the surgical.
Can I say one more thing? Can
oh,
I
yes,
say
please.
One more thing?
Go ahead.
These hormones also put kids at great risk for cardiovascular disease.
Really? And how does that work?
Well, I mean, when you mess up the hormone, the normal hormone levels in your body, it has a whole range of effects. It doesn't just mess up your endocrine system. Everything is affected. Your liver, your bones, your heart. It's just staggering to me that this is being allowed. And when I talk to people, it's so unbelievable. They say things to me that can't be happening. There's no way that that's allowed, but it is. Puberty is also about brain development. We don't know about the kinds of these hormones ravaging their little brains. And I've interviewed prostate cancer patients who are on this drug Lupron that I mentioned earlier. And, you know, the therapeutic idea is that it inhibits the flow of testosterone over their prostate, so prostate cancer tissue doesn't grow. And it does work. I know somebody was just on it, and he's recovering.
Right.
But if you go on these Lupron Facebook groups, they talk about the side effects, and it's the absolute worst experience of their life. They're glad that it's getting the cancer, but it's terrible. Now, imagine if old guys in their 50s and 60s are enduring this horror with this drug, and it's going for a good purpose to get rid of the malignant tumor or the polyps. Imagine what it's doing to a child's body and
brain. Right, right. Yeah, these are adults.
And
it's temporary. It's meant to be
temporary.
Right. Mm-hmm. But let's just say a few words about the surgical interventions, and then I want to get on to talk about the parents and how this is affecting the relation between parent and child. Yes, tell us how old are they when they're doing surgical interventions?
Well, it varies. I saw someone just sent me just today. The media is so propaganda. I can't emphasize this enough how much the mass media cheerleads for this movement. It was a 17-year-old boy who was castrated, and I mean, and I'm just going to call it what it is. He had his testicles surgically removed, and I don't know how they do this, but they invert the penis and they create a makeshift fake vagina, and then he'll have to dilate that to keep it open because it will normally close. It's like an open wound, but there's this dilation procedure. And so this one that was on Inside Edition talking about, they called him a pioneer, this poor boy who now looks like a girl and has a mutilated crotch area. He's 17. Jazz Jennings, who was the boy on that TLC show, I Am Jazz. Now keep in mind, he's been on the blockers and the hormones for a while. So at age 17 or 18, I don't know how old he was, he had the penis of a 9-year-old developmentally because the hormones had inhibited him, his genitals from developing. He'll never enjoy sex. He's sterilized. He's infertile. And so that's the boys.
I remember Jazz Jennings, they had a big party to celebrate the removal of his penis.
And they baked a cake with a penis on it.
And the surgery was painful. The surgery was very painful.
It was excruciatingly painful. And there's a picture of him that is seared in my memory of him in absolute agony.
Yeah.
And it was entertainment. This is what people are watching now as cool. I mean, it's, I mean, I've wept many nights over this. This has disturbed me and rattled me in a way that few things have. I can just say that. But for girls, there are girls as young as 13 who've had their breasts cut off in this country. Those are the youngest that I've read. Who knows, there might be younger, but reported there have been girls as young as 13. But it's all the rage now, I hear, on college campuses, and girls in their later teens are going to have this done. They're having double mastectomies, and a lot of times parents don't even know about it because they post pictures of their chest scars on Instagram. That's how they find out about it.
Oh my God.
Yeah, it's bad. It's so horrific.
So let's talk for a minute about the parents.
And sometimes they cut the nipples completely off.
You see why I have trouble reading his stuff?
Yeah.
People, I love him. I'm so glad you're doing it, Brandon, but oh man, and you know, I'm just gonna say, I'm an old lady, and mm-hmm. I drank a lot of the feminist Kool-Aid and stuff, you know, as a young woman. I had no idea how enjoyable breastfeeding was going to be. Mm-hmm. Until I did it, till I experienced it. It was like, oh my God. Mm-hmm. Oh, I mean, there's nothing like it, literally.
Yeah.
And you can't explain it. You can't describe it. And these, okay, let's talk briefly about the parents. So I know that there have been parents who have contacted you who have been horrified.
Yes.
And who have lost their parental rights in various ways. And then mm-hmm. there are parents of kids like Jazz Jenning, who obviously the parents are a part of the whole process. And so the parents are kind of all over the map, I suppose you would say. But take a few minutes to tell people a little bit about the parents in agony and what you've seen, some of what you've seen and heard.
Right. These are parents that somehow managed to get a hold of me. Either they contact me through Twitter, or I have, you know, radical feminist friends and colleagues who have pointed me in their direction, and others, and then my name just gets around, because these are desperate parents who realize that some of them, once they thought this was the right thing, and they went to these professional societies who said that, yeah, you need to transition your child if you don't want him or her to commit suicide, because that's the main deception that they use, that it's either, wouldn't you rather have a living daughter than a dead son, or the other way around. And so that's the mind trickery that they play, these evil people that, and therapists and psychiatrists that then steer them to these endocrinologists and other doctors that you would think first do no harm, but no, there's this whole cottage industry now that they're shepherding these kids into, and then they realize that this is not right, and then they panic and they scour the internet for dissenting voices, and then they realize, oh my God, what have I done? Right. And I've talked to some of these parents, and they call me, and they're horrified because their daughters have beards. And they got testosterone at Planned Parenthood, because that's the largest dispensary of transgender hormones now.
What? And
you didn't know that? Oh yes, they're in on this. This is their new financial. This is their what they're making money off of now.
Wow.
And I've read of cases where just a few visits, they get this. I mean, they like to say, oh yeah, there's a big mental health, you know, examination you go through before you get these hormones. No, I've talked with people that have gotten it on the spot, and they're just, it's easy peasy. As long as you're over 18, yeah, that's what it is. But if you go through a clinic, you can get hormones much earlier. But these parents they call me terrified, and their daughters are, and they're, it's mostly girls, parents of girls that have called me, but I've spoken with one who, it was a college in, I believe, in New Jersey, where the college facilitated his transition, and they're just panicked. They don't know what to do. And oftentimes, if they're minors, they're afraid to voice any objections, because in certain jurisdictions, liberal states mostly, and cities, if they object, it's seen as medical neglect, because you're child is not, it's just at warp speed, this movement is changing laws and policies and regulations, and so it's, they don't want to, they hide behind Twitter avatars. They're anonymous, and they can't, I mean, one mother called me, and she's met a group of mothers of gender dysphoric kids but they all found each other online behind fake names. And she knows them better than she knows any of her friends, because in liberal areas, if you don't support your trans child, you're seen as abusing him or her. And she knows them better, her friends that she's found online, but she doesn't even know their real names. Yeah. That's level, the depth to which they have to hide and conceal their anguish and pain. I have never heard such horror, such anguish, such fear and panic in the voices of anybody than these moms. I go to bed every night thinking about them.
Yes, and I have seen, it's come across my desk, situations where there's a divorce and one parent is supportive of the transition and the other is not.
Yeah.
And the family court right. inevitably in these cases where it's disputed like this, they'll favor the trans supportive parent.
Right. There's legal, there's an ex parte something or other in the court tool that is, I mean, the manipulation of the judicial system around this is extraordinary as well.
Yes, yes. Well, the family courts have a lot of such tools already
right.
at their disposal that are well honed for other purposes and now are
right.
being wheeled into place for this purpose.
Exactly.
So just briefly, who's behind this movement? Who are these people? Who's promoting transgender medicine and the transgender ideology? Who are these people and what do they want?
Well, it's a collaboration of several people. There, I know that this, we've talked that in the show notes you're going to list and one of the articles I'm going to reference now, but big pharmaceutical companies, and there's a family called the Pritzker family. They're a big player. They're not the only one. One of them is now the current governor of Illinois,
mm-hmm.
and his Jennifer Pritzker. It's his one of his family members. I'm not sure if it's cousin or sister or whatever. They're big into this, and one of that whole family stands to profit handsomely from this medicalization of young bodies. So think about
this. They're in the pharmaceutical business. That's a point.
The pharmaceutical medical device. Another major actor of this. Is the Human Rights Campaign, the leading gay rights organization in the country. They see this as the next frontier of civil rights, when really what it is a big, it's state power grab. It's a
and
big.
Why do they think? And what's your analysis and understanding of the Human Rights Campaign's thought process? What do you think they're up to? Why is this the next move for them?
Well, and I've talked about this with dissident. You know, gays and lesbian friends of mine who mm-hmm. who have told me that the gay rights movement looks nothing like what it did as recently as 3 years ago. But after they won gay marriage, it was like, so hey, I have all this money and influence. What do they do now? And so part of it could be we just need something to do. But it's, you know, it beggars belief. I mean, I don't know really what they want except more power. And, it, you know, I have... It's interesting because, and I know with your work with the sexual state, your book and your advocacy against the sexual revolution, your exposure of all of the harms, there are people who saw this coming. I could not have imagined the horrors that I now see. I mean, there's people who can predict what they see on the horizon, but I certainly could have never foreseen this. Honestly, I think it's just... it's a cultural Marxist power grab, and if people are hungry for power, and it's, I mean, I'm as bewildered as anybody, even as I'm in the thick of this on a regular basis. So what exactly they want, I just say more power, but that's just a very simple answer.
So here's my thought about it. And I didn't predict it either. Okay. I'll just admit that flat out, but round about a few years before the Obergefell decision, I could see that what was enabling the gay marriage juggernaut to go, was the fact that people had already accepted some of its premises. And
right.
one of the things that people had already accepted is the idea that the body is not very significant. You know, so if you have sex with a man or with a woman, it really doesn't matter very much. And of course, mentally, they've already sterilized the sexual act anyway. They've already kind of removed children out of the equation. So, you know, so what difference does it make? You know, if the body is not significant, gay marriage, the idea that marriage could be a gender-neutral institution and, right. and that there'd be no problem associated with that,
right.
that idea moved the ball forward of saying gender doesn't matter, the sex of the body doesn't matter. And so I think that's part of why they wanted gay marriage. They didn't want gay marriage because they needed benefits or whatever. That was ridiculous. I mean, all those problems were solved years before.
Right.
You know, so what they wanted was to really undermine the gender binary, and gay marriage was a tool for doing that. And once they got that, it's like, okay, now what? And I didn't predict that it would right. go as crazy as it has gone.
Right.
But now that it has, you can kind of look back on it and go, yeah, all along, there have been people who have resented the fact of male and female and who are undermining male and female in a variety right. of different ways. And this is the latest and most toxic.
I think that's an important insight. I'll say very quickly too, the article that I was referencing that everyone who's watching this needs to read is called "Who Are the Rich White Men Institutionalizing Transgender Ideology?" from my friend Jennifer Bielik. It gives you a rundown as to like these are the revenue streams. These are the people who stand to make a buck, a handsome buck off of this kind of highly specialized medicalization that is not ethical medicine at all, but this is, you got to follow the money if you want to know where this stuff is. I'll also just say too that it's been fascinating to me to see gays and lesbians who message me, who and they say this is the real conversion therapy, because
what do you mean? What do they mean when they say?
Well,
that?
It really is. This thing is like we were saying. We could never have predicted this. Because of it's so just wild and horrible, but it's almost even passé to be gay now. If you're not gay or lesbian, you're trans or non-binary. It's just they've gone on to the next thing, and if you're same-sex attracted, you're told, well, maybe you're really the opposite sex.
So
people say, well, this is, you're transing the gay away, and this is unlike the kind of stuff that gets thrown at, you know, Christians who. Maybe there's pastoral counseling for people who are dealing with unwanted same-sex attraction. They call that praying the gay away or conversion therapy, whatever. This is actual conversion therapy in the sense that you're introducing real drugs and surgical interventions and devastating harms to people, again, in pursuit of the physically impossible goal of becoming the opposite sex.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And the gay identity is left behind.
Yes.
But there's some new identity, new, even more radical, radically destabilizing identity. So.
And it's the lesbians who are mistreated the most.
See, that I've been seeing that too. I've been telling people then the LGBT people, the L's and the T's are at war, actively at war.
And most of the LGBT organizations are all about the T, heavily propped up by the G. The L's are just marginalized.
They're not useful anymore. During the campaign for gay marriage, it was very useful to have non-threatening looking, charming women couples with children. That was charming and that was useful. That was politically useful. Well, they're done with those people. They've thrown them under the bus.
The misogyny and the stuff that is directed at lesbians is off the charts abominable. I could tell you stories that would make.
I won't even go there. Yeah. You've blown people's minds enough for one day. Would you call this an example of the sexual deep state at work? The way in which the big foundations and the state are, you know, in some and the business, the big business people.
The corporate, you know, financing of this. This is absolutely a top-down operation by wealthy elites. Who, again, they stand to make a lot of money off of these medications and surgical interventions, and they're propped up by mass media companies, and the only people who are voicing objections to it are journalists such as myself, the Christian Post. Obviously, we have a perspective. It's not hidden. We're informed. Our reporting is informed by the gospel, and we biblical lens. That's people know what they're getting when they read us. But
right.
You know, if reporting is truthful, it stands on its own. And so it's only people who, the only people raising objections are those who are knowledgeable of the truth of the human person, and they know
right.
that it is physically impossible to change sex. Human right. beings cannot change sex. It cannot be said enough.
And you know, I think history will show that it was only the people of faith who had the courage to stand up against it, and who had the sense to say
right.
that something was really wrong. And it,
right.
you know, okay, it's an article of faith to say, well, in the beginning, God created male and female. But, you know, it's an article of faith to say you can unmake male and female. I mean, you want to talk about a non-science-based article of faith. You know, that's pretty crazy right there. So,
I think you're right. People of faith and a few other brave dissenters
right.
know the truth. And there are a few, and God bless them.
yeah. Well, and God welcome them into the church. You know, we need
right.
those people. I know you're all about that. You and I have had this conversation before. We're all
yeah.
about holding the door of the church open. That's my attitude about it. So, Brandon, what can people do to help our listeners? What can we do? What can people do?
The most important thing people can do, I think, is to push past their inhibitions, their fears, and start speaking up, because courage inspires more courage.
Yep.
People, and they have to get educated, because, again, I've talked about this. You know, I live and work in Washington, D.C., but when I come home to the countryside where my folks live to visit, I dare to speak about this subject, they look at me as though I have five heads. They can't believe that this is going on, because it just seems so outrageous. I just want to say, speak up and start voicing your objections, because then there will be a critical mass and some possible organizing to rise up and object and get laws or legislate some kind of meaningful social reform
right.
and greater exposure of this, of not only the highly unethical medical practices, but the media's complicity in covering it up.
Right.
Because if there's, that to me, the journalistic malpractice in completely framing coverage of what ought to be the most gigantic medical scandal in that country ever since
right.
we practiced eugenics on black slaves. And I mean, this is, I cannot underscore how deep and extensive this goes, and how journalists will not report on it if they work for a mainstream outlet, because it's seen as
right.
anti-LGBT. So start speaking out. But if they want like a practical thing to do, shall I explain the Kelsey Coalition petition?
Why don't you just briefly, because it's a little bit complicated, but just tell
yeah.
people that there is a petition out there
That's,
that they should be informed about. Tell them just a little bit about it, Brandon.
There's a petition to get the National Institutes of Health to investigate a study. It was a petition for an investigation of a study on puberty blockers, on these drugs, where they found out, an endocrinologist I know, they found out that they lowered the age of cross-sex hormones to be given to children as young as eight. Eight-year-old, so think of an eight-year-old girl being injected with testosterone, or an eight-year-old boy being injected with estrogen. That's what's been formalized in this grant that was given in 2015 to a children's hospital in Los Angeles with one of the doctors that is leading the way in this stuff.
Yes.
And so there's a petition for this $5 million plus grant to be investigated. That's just one practical step. I know
yes.
that's going to be listed in the show notes.
Yes.
It was put together by a group of mothers, who some of whom I've met, had in my home for dinner, who are absolutely exhausted, and they're trying to resist. These poor moms, they're just suffering so much. And their kids.
And so I'm gonna
yeah.
pause right there. That'll all be in the show notes. People can see
right.
this. That here's another concrete thing that I would like for people to do. If you know somebody who's struggling with this in their family, doggone it, support support the parents who are resisting it.
Yes.
Because
those
people are under
Yeah.
so much pressure
Oh.
that they have to go around anonymous and so on and so forth. You will be a big help to them.
Right.
And, you know, and if somebody tells you, well, you know, unless my daughter is allowed to come as the ring bearer at the wedding instead of the flower girl, you know, that person, you need to tell that person, no, that's not going to happen at my wedding.
Right.
But if you've got parents who are resisting this, you gotta be there for them. I can't emphasize that enough. You know, they're so isolated. The social isolation is a huge part of how this keeps going. Don't you
and
think,
I also
Brandon?
think, I also think, I want to say this too. We need people to be bold.
Yep.
And I'll just say there's an article that I just filed yesterday. It's going live soon. Maybe it has already. We need to rip the mask off some of these things. I mean, there's a procedure that is done called a radial forearm phalloplasty.
Oh,
this Dr. Jay, I have to describe this because people need to see this so they know that this is real. But for some girls who they don't just get the top surgery, as it's euphemistically called, where they remove the breasts, they take, in order for a girl who believes she's a boy, a, you know, teenage girl or young woman in college or whenever they get it done, they strip the flesh, surgically strip the flesh from her forearm, down layers of the flesh down to the bone, or I don't know how much they take off, but they take off enough. Then they graft the skin from the leg, and they use that arm flesh to make a fake pseudo penis, and they then attach it somehow between her legs, and it doesn't work. It's not functional, but that's they're taking flesh off of her arm to make fake genitals. It doesn't.
Of course, it doesn't work.
And so we need people, but there's a woman that I know that has made a poster of that in England, and she's ripping the mask off what's being done to people, and she's holding it up in front of, you know, conferences, indoctrinating teachers to do this stuff. You've got to expose this so people will know.
Yeah, and didn't you tell me about a child who had had multiple corrective surgeries after this because it didn't work?
I've heard of a case, and I'm trying to verify this, but my source, I know she does not lie about these things, where a woman had this done, and she had to have, I think, approximately 30 or so, dozens of follow-up procedures. They mutilated her crotch area so bad that she now carries around with her a colostomy bag and now has to urinate through her anus. That's what was done. Because they're not fixing anything.
Right.
There's nothing wrong with her body.
There was nothing broken in the first place.
There was nothing
right.
broken.
You know, another whole shocking area that we could talk about that we won't talk about that I'll get a different guest on to talk about is the fact that these procedures are done with so little screening and
yes.
attention to the other issues that might be driving the gender dysphoria.
Yes.
And so perhaps our friend Walt Heyer or James Shoup or some yes. of these people who have lived as transgenders
mm-hmm.
And who have desisted from it,
right.
We should hear from them at some point too, right? So
yes.
I find it shocking that even the insurance companies don't require more investigation before they invest all this money in these procedures that somebody doesn't really need. What the heck is going on there, you know? That's all part of the propaganda process or the social contagion, I think, is a good term for it, yeah.
There's so much pressure on any group to not resist any of this, because if you don't do this, they're going to commit suicide. Like
right.
that's their main threat. And once you realize that that's just hogwash, and in fact, suicidality increases after transition.
Right.
That's, we know there's a study out of Sweden where that they measured every case and
yeah.
found that the suicidality was actually much higher after, you know, post-op. But you're correct. I've interviewed James Shoup, and he's told me psychological or psychiatric issues are not they're immediately tied to gender now. They're not. There is no exploration. It's stunning the speed with which people are funneled off to the gender
right.
clinics. That there's now 55 of them or so in the United States that were not here 10 years ago.
Right.
It's just exploded.
Right.
In the last decade. And so people don't realize how quickly this has all developed. But the endocrinologists with whom I have interviewed as I've researched this issue say the best thing to do is if your child is is experiencing some kind of, issue with his or her body, and he's confused, or to get a family counselor that is not drinking the Kool-Aid. I know they can be hard to find, but find one because they're out there. And parents have to get past the fact that, especially if there is some kind of conflict in the home, that they may be unwittingly contributing to that child's distress. Mm-hmm. But don't dare anybody take a kid to a gender specialist, right, or a gender clinic anywhere. Right. Stay as far away from them as you possibly can.
Right. Because you'll never get to the underlying psychological issue, whatever it might be. You'll never get to it.
It will immediately be assumed that they were born in the wrong body, or that they are authentically themselves as the opposite sex.
Right. Right. Well, I'd like to encourage all of our listeners and viewers to follow Brandon Showalter on the Christian Post, follow his writings over there, and you can follow him on Twitter, at Brandon M. Show is his Twitter handle. And also, we, of course, want to encourage you to follow and like the Ruth Institute on Facebook. We've got a lot of activity going on over there. And if you enjoy this show, please give it a positive review and share it with your friends. And the information about the petition that Brandon mentioned, we're going to have that in the show notes as well, so you can get yourself informed about that as well. Brandon, I want to thank you so much. Before I let you go, I have one last question that I want to ask you, and that is, if you don't mind telling us, what is your faith tradition?
Well, I like to call myself an Anglicostal. I'm sort of a mutt. I was raised a Mennonite, but I go to an Anglican church now, but I also have some Assembly of God Pentecostal in my background. Went to a sort of a charismatic Bible school, so I'm a mutt, but I love liturgy, I love sacrament, I love the fire of the Holy Spirit, so I say Anglicostal.
Well, Brandon, I want to thank you for sharing your expertise with all of our listeners, and permit me to say, brother, that you would make a great Catholic someday.
You know, a lot of people want me on the Tiber swim team, I hear.
Door's open.
Well, okay.
But you know what?
I have great love and respect for the Catholic Church, and saints of God are wonderful Catholics.
Well, thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that. And the Ruth Institute, as you know, we're all across the religious spectrum, even on our staff, amongst our followers. And it just shows that people across the faith traditions are very concerned about all of these issues that you're doing so much to bring to light. And I really, really appreciate your reportage and your courage, and prayers and blessings on your work, brother.
Thank you so much, Dr. J. It's a privilege to be with you.
Thank you.
You've been watching The Dr. J. Show, featuring a personal interview with Brandon Showalter.
For all the saints who from their labors rest.
Alexander Solzhenitsyn said, "The simple act of the ordinary brave man is not to participate in lies, not to support false actions. His rule is, let that come into the world, let it reign supreme, only not through me."
Alleluia. Alleluia.
And now for the most important part of our program, your action item for this week. Men dressed up as women and calling themselves drag queens are increasingly being hosted by the public libraries of our great nation. Under tax expense, they capture the imagination and play of childhood. They give the smallest and most vulnerable children glamorous and unabashedly queer role models. If you object to drag queen story hours coming to your library, then tell Wanda K. Brown, president of the American Library Association. You can sign our petition against drag queen story hours at lifepetitions.com. Just click on the petition to tell U.S. libraries to stop pushing drag queens on our kids. And that's our action item for this week. And finally, here's Dr. Morse for a word of advice and encouragement.
what listeners and readers and watchers need to understand about this. You must not be silent. There are millions of us who have been harmed by the sexual revolution. If we all spoke out, George Soros and Paul Singer and the Rockefeller Foundation do not have enough money to silence all of us.
You've been watching The Dr. J Show, a production of the Ruth Institute. The Ruth Institute equips Christians to defend the family and build a civilization of love. Check out our website at ruthinstitute.org for helpful resources and support. Join us on Facebook. Our podcasts can also be found online at ruthinstitute.org. I'm Father Mark Hodges. Thank you for watching.